Hi, today I have something called Growcube, which seemed like an interesting find. And in this video, I want to take a closer look and see if I can create a custom firmware for this. I opened the packaging and according to the user manual, it says smart automatic watering kit. So let's see if there is actually anything that makes it smart. The main item in the packaging is this white box labeled Growcube, though its shape isn't exactly a cube. Anyway, it also includes 4 soil humidity sensors and some hose, a 12-volt power adapter, and a few plastic holders for the hoses. I didn't read the manual, but I guess the idea is to fill the water here, connect the soil humidity sensors, and based on the measurements, it waters your plants according to the set value. Here are the water outlets. They are either separate pumps or a pump with a 4 selenoid setup. There is also an app, which I haven't installed, that lets you select plant type and automatically sets the watering schedule. Other than that, there is no manual control button or anything else, so you have to install the app. Otherwise, I don't think you can use the device at all. I want to remove all these bags and check what's inside the box first. The user manual mentions that this device can connect to a network, and in my experience, devices with Bluetooth or Wi-Fi usually have a reprogrammable chip inside, which is exactly what I am hoping for. There are 4 pads underneath the box, so I think the screws are hidden under them. Yes, they are. Give me a few seconds. If you also decide to open this, there are 2 hidden hex screws under the label, so don't force it before removing them. Under the bottom cover, there is a single pump and 4 solenoids, so software-wise, it should be easy to control this device. After removing these screws, the whole subassembly comes out, and the components that make this work are in my hand right now. The rest is just plastic. Here is the main PCB after I removed it from the pump assembly. Let's take a closer look at it under the microscope. Right after putting it under the microscope, I spotted the most interesting part, an ESP12F module. There have been discussions on the Reddit about the suitability of ESP modules in products. Most of the questions come from makers who had cool projects and ideas, but they were hesitant to use them in consumer products. Well, here's a real-life example, an ESP12 module, which contains an ESP8266 chip. The most important thing is meeting the customer requirements. If an ESP module fits the bill, why not use it? If you have cool ideas you have developed, I love to see them as products on the market, and I'd even be happy to review one if you send me one. Right next to ESP module, there's an yaml chip. I couldn't find the exact datasheet, but I am pretty sure it's an EEPROM, and they are probably using it to store user settings on it. The larger chip on the right is from NXP, marked as PCA9555, and it is an I/O expander. Since ESP12F doesn't have many pins, they are using this I/O expander to control most of the components. Let's move to the right a little. A nice thing I have noticed here are the UART, flush, and reset markings. This is great because it means we can upload our own custom firmware without too much hassle. We can even use Arduino to program the ESP module here. If we move a little further to the right, we'll find a buzzer along with another small chip. It has the Texas Instruments symbol, but when I checked the markings, nothing came up. However, I have a trick for you. If you can't find the part number but can read the marking on the chip, manufacturers usually have a part marking lookup page to identify it. For example, marking on the chip was bogey, and if I look it up, it says ADS1115 16-bit ADC chip. It makes sense because ESP8266 doesn't have enough ADC channels. It has one, and even that isn't great. So they're using this 4-channel ADC chip to measure the voltage levels from the soil humidity sensors. These metal parts are for the humidity sensors that come with the device. Since there are 4 humidity sensors, there are 4 ADC channels on this chip. If we move up a little, there are 2 buttons. One of them is marked as EEPROM and other one is unmarked. This black part is the temperature and the humidity sensor, marked as DHT20. It works on the I2C bus. On the bottom right, there is another chip, and next to it, a battery. If you see a battery next to a chip, it's usually a real-time clock. It is the S1307 and works on I2C bus too. If we move to the left of the PCB, we can see the circuitry that drives the relays. There are 5 relays on this board with 1 unpopulated slot. The relays are used to drive the mini pump and also 4 solenoids. If we move to the top left part of the PCB, we see a current monitor. This one also works on the I2C bus. You have your LEDs, blue and red, and you connect solenoids and the pumps to these connections. These were the most interesting parts on this PCB. We can easily program this board by soldering headers here and using a USB to UART converter like this one. Since there is an ESP on the board, I highly recommend a great project called ESPhome if you haven't heard of it already. I think it's perfect for this device. It integrates well with the Home Assistant and is very easy to use. And instead of writing code, you configure the hardware using YAML files. Personally, I think ESPhome is one of the best open source projects for the home automation. Installation process is very simple. All you have to do is type pip3 install wheel after installing the Python, and then you type pip3 install ESPhome, and that's it. It will install all the necessary toolchains and the files just with one code. I created a file called growcube.yaml, and now we can start editing it. To upload ESPhome to the board, I soldered pin headers onto PCB and connected a USB to UART adapter like this. For convenience, I also soldered 2 buttons onto PCB for the boot and reset pins. You can program it by pressing both buttons at the same time. And you can release them afterwards, just like you would on a Node MCU or similar boards. To upload our first firmware, simply type ESPhome run growcube.yaml and hit enter. Even uploading a blank ESPhome firmware with the cables is an important step because it makes everything easier later on. For example, I have now started configuring the YAML file further. First, I want to try using the IO expander since it controls quite a few components. And again, I am running ESPhome run growcube.yaml and press enter. Then it will download all the necessary toolchains, frameworks, and plus the libraries on its own without doing anything. Once that's done, you'll have the option to upload new firmware over the air, which is great for development or adding new features without dealing with the cables. Now if I type 2 and hit enter, it will upload the new firmware through the Wi-Fi. To integrate it into Home Assistant, you should install ESPhome integration if you haven't done so already. To add our newly created device to Home Assistant, go to Settings and then Devices and Services, and afterwards type ESPhome and just click on it and install the Growcube and press Submit. Afterwards, you need to put the password which you set into your YAML files. Now, Home Assistant is successfully communicating with our board. Unfortunately, pin 0 of the I/O expander isn't controlling anything, so nothing happens. Since we have set it up correctly, the rest of the steps are easy. For the test, I have only used a single pin of the I/O expander. I can simply list all the pins in the YAML file and upload the code again by typing ESPhome run growcube.yaml and upload it via Wi-Fi. Now I can control all the pins of the I/O expander. Let's check if I can trigger something on the PCB. Here is our first blinky, but using ESPhome and Home Assistant. Isn't it always exciting to see this? I could have done the same thing by following the traces, but I think finding out what controls what this way is much more fun. Here is the buzzer test. It was also connected to one of the pins of the I/O expander. There is a DHT20 temperature and humidity sensor on the board. Don't confuse it with DHT10 or DHT22 because this one works on I2C bus. So DHT integration won't work on this. I couldn't find the DHT20 integration, but EHT10 uses the same driver. I'll just use that one instead. You can try similar sensors if you can't find an exact match online, and they usually just work. I'll just use this integration instead on my YAML file. Let's test if our integration works. I'll hold my finger on it and check if the temperature rises as a result. So the temperature is slowly rising, and it means that our integration is working smoothly. All there is left to figure out which relay is controlling which solenoid. I installed the pump and solenoid assembly back again, and I've already figured out which pin is controlling the micro pump. But now I need to figure out solenoids. First, I'll try to trigger them from Home Assistant and feel the corresponding solenoid with my finger. Well, this didn't work. I can hear the solenoids, but I can't tell which one is triggering. So I'll try something else. There are test pads under the board for the solenoids. I can simply use those with a multimeter, but it's a little bit boring. So instead, I'll start installing everything back and continue developing the YAML file on the assembled unit. I installed everything back, including some hoses for the testing. As you can see, there are markings for the soil humidity sensors, and I want to match those in the firmware. Let's plug the power socket back in for now. I attached the hoses to a terminal block for now and marked them for identification. I'll add some water to the container and see if it works. Let's not forget to close the lid as well. Since Home Assistant has an app, testing was very easy. I already figured out the solenoid pins but couldn't determine which one is which, so I'll simply switch them on and off in the app to identify them. This is much easier than tracing the PCB thanks to ESPhome and Home Assistant. After the test, I took notes and will update the YAML configuration file with the correct names. This will make setting up automation much easier. The device comes with 4 soil humidity sensors. I'll take one of them and already fill the cup with water and dip the sensor in to see if the voltage values change using the Home Assistant app. The soil sensors have magnets on them, so be careful not to install them incorrectly. Even without placing it in water, it reads around 2.2 volts, so this is the dry measurement of the soil sensor. This corresponds to 0% humidity. Now let's dip into water and get the wet measurement. When placed it in cup, it reads around 5 volts, which equals 100% humidity. Since I figured out channel A, and I will continue by removing it from the current port and install it in the other ports in order. Okay, the test is now complete. I am taking notes again to remember what I found, then I'll update the YAML file with the new changes. I think instead of displaying the voltage values, I'll change the unit of measurements from volts to percentage. I think it's more meaningful for such an application. I updated the code again, and I think we can consider the firmware complete. Now I'll install it on real plants and see how it performs. There are also nice silicone water distributing nozzles, and I am curious to see how they will work as well. I currently have 2 plants at home. I used to have more, but unfortunately they died because I wasn't very responsible with their care. I either forget to water some of them or overwater others, turning the soil into a swamp. I'm not really a plant expert, but in my Home Assistant setup, I plan to set the soil humidity around 50%. If it drops the threshold, it should water the plant around 1 second, and after a few minutes, it can do it again. I don't even know the name of this plant, but if you know the name of it, please share it down in the comments so I can set it up correctly. For example, take a look at this app. The plant on the right is basically submerged in water, while the plant on the left is like living in the desert. It would also be nice to check how they are doing if I leave home for a few days. I can simply monitor their watering levels from the app. But you should probably remove the unused solenoids from the configuration to avoid accidentally activating them and watering down your furniture instead. Now I can easily automate it through a Home Assistant, and at least my plants will live longer. Because these plants look like they are about to die due to miswatering. Now it is integrated into Home Assistant without any issues. I'll put the YAML file in the description if you are also interested in this setup. Well, that's about it. If you liked the video, don't forget to give a thumbs up, and see you next time.